go.
Hello and welcome to The Worst Movie Ever Made, an experimental movie podcast designed with one thing in mind, to find the worst movie ever made. However, this week, we're doing a good movie. Every 9 episodes or so, we do a good movie. Hey, Rob, how are you? And why are we doing this?
Well, I'm doing moderately okay. You might notice that the background in the Zoom meeting is not my living room. It's rather, it's Nolensville Pike in Nashville, Tennessee.
I see that.
My wife had to work some night shifts because she works in the food and beverage industry, as we are all so familiar with.
Yes, unfortunately.
She's a supervisor / trainer, which basically means middle management, which means stomping out fires from people below you while not getting paid to do what the manager's supposed to do. So she had to cover for some people. Kids won't sleep, so we're taking the show on the road.
Nice. Awesome. That should add some fun.
Yeah, and we're here to talk about Raising Arizona with Nicolas Cage.
Yeah. Plenty of driving in that one, too, so it makes sense.
Yeah.
All right, let's hop right into it, man.
Okay.
I'm going to give you a couple good reviews.
Sounds good.
Tom Shales of the Washington Post. Raising Arizona is a prize package and a bundle of joy. One that puts a fresh, funny face on the American comedy movie. It's as encouraging as it is entertaining.
Fair assessment. Very fair assessment.
And then Rita Kempley of the Washington Post also. It's a wacky, happy, daring, darkly comic tale of parenting outside the law. It celebrates the middle-of-the-road dreams of decidedly off-center folks.
For a movie about abducting children, it's pretty feel-good.
It is. Yeah, it is. I'm assuming the YouTube comment section was a bit different this week, as it's not a bad movie.
Yeah, it was mostly high praise. None of the comments were really funny. There were some shade thrown on Nicolas Cage, but we've talked about that at length, where it's like, I think he's great all around. He's as good as the movie that he's in, and if it's a good movie, he makes it better. And we're pretty much, some people are like, oh, he started just taking movies for a paycheck. Like, that's why anybody takes movies, so I'm not mad.
Sure. Yeah. No, exactly. That's what they're doing for a living.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, so the first test of the Keystone apparatus still, even though we're doing a good movie. So we're going to get the community sense and average on Rotten Tomatoes for their critic scores. So we're taking 7 different movies, all their critic scores, averaging them out, and then comparing Raising Arizona to that to see if it's better or worse.
All right.
So let's get into test number 1, the Keystone apparatus.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, step up to witness my latest creation, the darn tune enraging, inducing, convoluted, highfalutin Keystone apparatus. You want to know if you're predator or prey? Then step this way and have your say. Wait, oh no, what's happening? Something is going terribly wrong!
The Keystone apparatus.
All right, the first one I have here is The Lady Killers with Tom Hanks.
Okay.
You seen that?
I don't think I have.
It's not great. There's a bunch of good actors in it, but Tom Hanks is obviously like the boss, you know?
Yeah.
I got a 54.
Okay.
Hail Caesar, which I didn't even know about, has Josh Brolin and George Clooney. And I think it was 2016. Got an 85.
Okay. I've heard of it and I remember the movie poster, but I haven't seen it.
The Ballad of Buster Scruggs with Tim Blake Nelson. That guy has a very Ernest P. Worrell kind of vibe to him.
Yeah.
Have you seen that? It's like a Netflix original.
I haven't. I haven't seen a lot of Netflix originals because a lot of them suck. But now
that one's pretty good.
Check it out.
Yeah, I got an 89. It is good. Intolerable Cruelty with Clooney again and Catherine Zeta-Jones got a 76.
Okay.
Time to Kill with Cage.
Yep.
I went with the audience score because it wasn't critically reviewed.
Okay.
Got a 20%.
Okay.
I have 2 more here. Barton Fink with Goodman and Turturro got a 90. I've heard that's incredible, but I've never seen it. And then Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? With Clooney, Turturro, and Tim Blake Nelson, funny enough, got a 78%.
Okay.
For an average of 70%, Raising Arizona, do you want to guess?
90s. It's got to be in the 90s.
91.
Okay.
So it is by far Predator, very good movie compared to its, you know, pretty good competition. Honestly, most of those movies were good. All right, so let's get into test number two. This is the elevator movie plot pitch, same as for our bads, just for a comparison point. But again, I'm going to ask you the same couple questions I've been asking you lately once I read this one. So it's not about how much time it takes me, but I'm going to try to make it succinct just to prove the point.
Sure.
Let's do test number two, the elevator movie plot pitch.
The elevator movie plot pitch.
A con and a policewoman get hitched. Life was good until they found out they could not have children. The cop and con hatch a plot to forcefully adopt one of five quintuplets born in their town. Hijinks ensue as their decisions destroy their karma. That's it.
I watched the shit out of that, and I did.
And it was awesome.
Yeah.
And it's, I think it's pretty believable. You know, it's not something that happens in every town. But it's not that much of a stretch.
There's a whole thing. This movie is like, you need to suspend a healthy amount of disbelief, but once you have it suspended, you're like, yeah, that can happen.
Yeah, exactly. What was your star grade for that one?
I'll give that 5 stars.
Okay, perfect. I mean, that just goes to show. Let's do test number three, the incredible dialogue counter. So okay. I'm going to give you 10 lines of dialogue in reverse order. And number 10 is the least good of the 10, and number 1 is the best. So we're going to read off the lines of incredible dialogue here with a couple of clips.
Okay.
Let's do test number 3, the incredible dialogue.
Something poignant and relevant to the story. Something equally smart and observant.
Rob, how are you making those play?
Don't worry about it. I got a guy.
All right. Number 10. I wanted to mention all of the different okay thens.
Okay.
Because there's like 12 different characters that say okay then. It must just be like the town's go-to saying.
It's the South. Like, okay then. Like, I could, yeah.
Okay then. Yeah. Number 9. This is High talking about... how Holly Hunter was not fertile, right?
Yeah.
He says, her insides were a rocky place where my seed could find no purchase. I don't know why. I just really love that one.
That's what I mean about like the really crude language that's like so elegantly put.
Yeah.
They nail it in this movie.
They really do. All right. So this will be our first audio clip of the episode. So we're going to send it over to John Goodman for this one.
All right, 1 second. I'm merging.
Where's the baby?
Where's the baby?
Damn it, John! Ain't we got enough to contend with?
I don't know, ma'am. I thought we left the phone on the roof.
You never leave a baby!
I think we left over at the bank, too.
Miss Madonna, I worry sick about him.
Hold on, A-John. Don't put the heart on him. A-John!
Madonna!
Hey!
Miss Madonna!
Okay, so John Goodman there is, you know, the ink bomb just exploded in the car, and they're screaming because the car's going to crash, and they forgot the baby again.
Yeah.
And then they get pulled over, basically. Like, they almost crash into High and Ed, and they get out. They don't know it, but H.I. opens the door, and Holly Hunter on the other side, they open the doors, and they're like, where's the baby, right? And then John Goodman there says... don't you see that we have enough to contend with? like they shouldn't be bothering them when they're dealing with the ink bomb and all that stuff. It's like, it's just a really funny line to me anyway. Number 7, Nathan Arizona, who I loved, by the way. I love this guy.
Yeah.
He's talking to like one of his, I don't know, one of his employees over the phone at his house, you know?
Yeah.
And he says, if a frog had legs, it wouldn't bump its ass a hop. Or if a frog had wings, it wouldn't bump its ass a hop.
Yeah.
Which is like a perfect like Arizona thing to say, you know. Number 6 is Nathan Arizona again. He says, After he talks to the reporters and they're like speculating whether it was a kidnapping or a UFO abduction or what.
Yeah.
He's walking away and he's like, it's still business as usual at Unpainted Arizona. If you can find lower prices anywhere, my name still ain't Nathan Arizona.
I love it because, I mean, they don't make him out to be a villain because they weren't being negligent, really. They just like, they got robbed blind, basically.
Yeah.
But he's such a businessman. He didn't fail to see the opportunity for all the free press and advertising he'd get.
Yeah. Just kind of shows the sort of guy he is. It's like, he is kind of a good guy. We come to find out.
Yeah.
But he's always plugging, which we should do more of. Who knows? You remember the truck driver guy when Nick Cage pulls him over, like with the gun and then makes him drive? Yeah. The truck driver, as he gets pulled over, goes, son, you got a panty on your head. That was a family favorite of ours. Number four, High. After they stole the baby, High says, he's awful damn good. I think I got the best one. About the baby. All right, a few more. Number three, High again. So they are driving away from the scene of the robbery. Ed just picked him up and they're screaming at each other. And High's like, I never postured myself as a 3-piece suit type. And then he goes, turn here on the right, honey. Like mild tempered. They're screaming at each other. And he's like giving her very calm and cool directions. Cause like they really love each other, but it's a good device. I thought.
Yeah.
Two more, this second one, and then we're going to do another clip.
Okay.
Okay, so number two, the second best line of dialogue is the prison mate. In the beginning, do you remember the guy who was in, like, the bunk above him?
With the crawdads.
Yeah, he says, when there wasn't no crawdads to eat, we ate sand. And High says, you ate sand? We ate sand. I can't imagine eating sand.
Yeah.
And that there would be any nutritional value to that. So, all right. And the number one best line of dialogue from this movie, Raising Arizona, okay. Comes to you in the form of a clip. So, John Goodman involved again. Let it rip.
All right.
All right, you hasties, it's a stick up. Everybody freeze. Everybody down on the ground.
Well, which is it, young feller? You want I should freeze or get down on the ground? Mean to say, if I freeze, I can't rightly drop. And if I drop, I'm going to be in motion. You see?
Shut up!
Okay, then.
Everybody down on the ground!
How did you do that? Anyway,
My daughter is in the back seat with a boom mic, and my son is just like he's got a drill with a hot dog on it, and he puts on the right setting, and it spins and it swipes for me.
Oh, that's incredible!
Yeah,
you gotta engineer it somehow.
Oh yeah.
Well, anyway, that line there just made me like, I don't know, still makes me laugh every day. I've seen this movie so many times, but when John Goodman is giving everyone directions and then the old timer points out that they are in direct contrast of one another, that you cannot possibly freeze and drop to the ground at the same time. And then John Goodman just loses his shit. And he's like, shut up. Oh my God. It's the best. All right, there you go. Those are your incredible lines of dialogue. If you think we missed out on anything, email us at Worst Movie Ever Made. We'll shout you out next episode. And we're moving on to test number four as we are flying along here. And this one we've been calling As Good as Goodman. That may change at some point, but it's very appropriate to hear because John Goodman is heavily involved in this one. So test number four, As Good as Goodman. Your good acting test. Let's do it.
Goodman. Goodman.
Oh, Goodman. Go to heaven.
All right, number one, I just wanted to mention Holly Hunter. as Ed. She does a lot of good acting. She had some spotty moments, I thought, but overall, very good performance.
Yeah.
You know, when they first get the kids, or the kid, and she's like, they're driving home, and she's like, I love him so much. Yeah. I love him. So she's like breaking down crying. I get it, though. Like, you know, she's been trying to have a kid for a long time now, and she finally has one, and she just totally loses it. And I don't think she went too far over, you know?
Yeah. Not appropriate reaction, because now you probably look at Aaron, and I look at Stacey, and it's like, when they see that she had the genuine reaction that a new mother has when they have a newborn that we both witnessed firsthand with, like, a kid. Sure. So I think it makes a stronger performance for her.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, she has other moments. I'm actually in a couple minutes here. I'm going to give you another one, but we're going to move to Nick Cage. You know the part where Glenn is saying that they should be like swingers together?
Yeah.
And Nick Cage punches him in the face, and then he turns to him and he's like, keep your goddamn hand off my wife. And he repeats it a couple times, and he looks like genuinely like he's going to murder Glenn, you know?
Yeah.
Number three, Holly Hunter, when she realizes that, when she, Ed, realizes that High is robbing the convenience store, and she gets out of the car to go around the other side and start driving, and she's like, you son of a bitch! Yeah. You son of a bitch! And then, like, a minute later, she like, cools down in the car, and she's like, hold on, son, we're gonna go pick up Daddy, and, like, that whole scene there, I thought she just killed it.
Yeah, she nailed that performance.
All right, now here we're going to get a little clip heavy, but this is because the acting in this movie is great. So we have a few people to shout out in and just let them do their own performances. So clip number three and four are coming together, so to speak. I mentioned Glenn. I didn't mention Dot, his wife, but let's start with Dot and let her just take it away for a couple seconds here.
Where's that baby? Where's the
egg? Go find him, honey.
Cut it out, Glenn.
He's asleep right now.
Oh, shit. I hope we didn't wake you.
Can I just sneak a peekaloo?
All right. I mean, she is a perfect example of that, like, very annoying but genuinely nice kind of, like, in your ass kind of snooty up your butt person, you know?
Yeah, like she brings a jello mold to every like corporate function.
Yeah, for sure. All right, I'm going to, before I say too much, just let Glenn take it away. Glenn, what do you have to say?
Need a beer, Glenn? Pope wear a funny hat?
Yeah, Glenn, I guess it is kind of funny.
Jake, that reminds me. How many Polacks take to screw up a light bulb?
I don't know, Glenn. One?
Nope. Takes three. Wait a minute. No, I told him wrong. Here, I'm starting again. How come it takes three Polacks to screw up a light bulb?
I don't know, Glenn.
Because they're so darn stupid. Shit, man. Listen up. What's the matter? Don't you get it?
No, Glenn, I sure don't.
Well, shit, man, I guess that's why they call it a way homer.
Why's that?
Because you only get it on the way home.
I'm already home, Glenn.
All right, so have you seen much Friends?
I watched, like, most of the run growing up because my mom and sister watched it, but, like, I'm not a fan, but I'm familiar with, like, the lore and a lot of, like, the in-jokes.
So this guy is Chandler's boss in Friends. And I don't know why every time, I mean, I've seen him in a few things, you know, he's a very familiar actor. He's never like the lead, but he, you know, he's always like kind of a tool. I don't know. He's always playing like some tertiary character who is obviously a tool bag, you know?
Yeah.
But I think he's great actually.
Yeah. He does that really good role of like he's like the company man. Cause he's the boss in this film. So it makes sense, but he's the guy that wears like the polo shirt and the cargo shorts to Disney World with his family.
Yeah, exactly.
And like, he has all the dumb Polack jokes.
So. Yeah, he does repeatedly. I love at the end, now that you mention it, they show Glenn pulled over on the side of the road and he's talking to the police officer whose name is like Kowalski or something. And it's in the dream, I think. And High is like, he told one too many pull-out jokes. And then the police officer like clicks the pen. He's about to write out like some huge ticket, you know? All right, two more clips and then we'll move on to our next test. Number five is Cage. And, you know, we said in the post description on, I think it was Monday morning, when we announced that we were doing this one, that Cage can really be great if he's trying.
Yeah.
And he's trying really hard with our next clip. So let's just let it rip.
My son, bitch.
Don't forget his phone call, lad.
Tell him I think he's a damn fool, Ed. You tell him I said so, H.I. McDonald.
And if he wants to discuss it, he knows where to find me. In the Maricopa County Maximum Security Correctional Facility for Men, State Farm Road, number 31, Tempe, Arizona. I'll be waiting.
I'll be waiting.
So he's, I entitled this one when I sent it over to you, I'll be waiting. And I think it's perfect because he dials it back down. You know, Ed's heartbroken. He's like in love with Ed already for some reason. I don't know.
Yeah.
He's pretty and everything, but they don't know each other that well. It's just that like mythical true love where you both just know it before you know each other, which isn't really a thing. But he gets so mad that her fiance leaves her that he like that, you know, he blows up, but he doesn't do the Cage like supernova. He just gets mad, you know, in like a very believable way.
Yeah.
And, you know, if I was the fiance and Ed told me that, I would be intimidated that some guy in like a maximum security penitentiary wants to kick my ass, you know? So I thought it was great.
Yeah. There's a whole thing with this movie. It's like I said, there's an example from our lives that I want to bring up. It's work related.
Yeah.
That reminds me of this movie. There's a guy we work with.
He
swapped off on like grill cook and you always in fry cooking. I was on dish or floating that night. But
yeah.
I never around the corner and he would just lean back, arms flailing, going, dumping a gallon bottle of water down his throat. And it's one of those things, like, because we're so used to that environment. Like,
yeah.
Oh, Jake probably said he's thirsty. You probably said something stupid. And then he took you up on the offer, and then you just started waterboarding him. And I just, like, struggled with that. And this whole movie's like that, where it's, like, it's kind of far-fetched, but, like, if you're in that universe, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah, for sure. And they do a great job establishing that universe right away with the opening monologue, which I'll get into more. But, yeah, you're right. As soon as you're comfortable with this universe, like, everything makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, last clip and last one for the As Good As Can Win segment. So this is great acting by Nathan Arizona, who I mentioned before. I really should have that actor's name because he deserves more credit from me here. But let it play and we'll see what you think about this clip here, Rob.
Of course. I know that.
Sir, we have an indication you were born Nathan Huff Hines. Is this correct?
Yeah, I changed my name. What of it?
Can you give us an indication why?
Yeah. Did you buy furniture at a store called Unpainted Huff Hines?
All right, I'll get to the point.
Was the child
wearing anything when he was abducted?
Nobody sleeps naked in this house.
I am asking the questions, officer.
If we're going to put an APB out, I need a description.
Just that we're better trained to intervene in a crisis situation. What was he wearing?
A dinner jacket. What do you think? He's wearing his damn jammies.
Child was wearing his jammies. You happy? Do you have any disgruntled employees?
Well, they're all disgruntled. I ain't running a damn daisy farm.
What did the
My motto
say?
Is do it my way or watch your butt.
So what you think it might have been an employee?
Oh, don't make me laugh. Without my say-so, they wouldn't piss with their pants on fire.
What did the pajamas
officer?
Look like?
I don't know. They were jammies. They had Yodas and shit on them.
All right, so the Yodas and shit line really gets me, but there's a few in there. You know, where he's like saying that it's a bigger monologue than the clip we played, but he's saying, you know, that he doesn't run a flower shop. So, of course, they're disgruntled. They wouldn't piss their pants if they were on fire or whatever. And then the Yodas and shit. And then, you know, he goes on to really get upset about the cops being in his house and not out looking for his child. And I totally get that. And I don't think he over-delivered. I think it was pretty perfect.
No, exactly. And like, he doesn't, like I said earlier, he never seems like a bad guy. He seems like, you know, like a hard businessman, but
yeah.
Even when he's like, I don't know, he's wearing fucking jammies. Like I was telling Stacy a while back, like, when Bowie was born, I couldn't pick her out of a 5-baby lineup. Like their faces are undistinct. Like it's really hard to, you know, put a face to them. It's just because like, they're kind of like they all kind of look the same. But then like you know, and like I was if she was 6 months old and got kidnapped, I'd probably have trouble picking her out of a lineup. I'm not a bad parent though for that. It's just
right. No, that's standard. You're just honest. But yeah, I thought that guy was pretty great.
Yeah.
Good old Nathan Arizona. All right, let's move it on to our next test, the work skill. Okay. So instead of talking about the things that don't taste quite right, like we normally do, which I will do, I promise, in our consistencies, additional musings, I'm going to talk about some of the stuff that didn't land right in 2022. But okay. For now, we're going to talk about the things that still work in this movie.
Yeah.
Not a huge section, but let's jump into test number 5, the work skill.
Oh my god, you can't say that. 2021.
No, actually, guys, it actually holds up.
Really?
Yeah, it really does.
Really? Totally.
Okay. What did you like the music? Like the intro music and stuff?
I was a fan, yeah. It had like that, like it was like hillbilly-ish, but like that, like rocking. Like, I don't know, it felt
The banjo is awesome and the whistling. Is really cool. I don't know. It's like something I normally wouldn't love, you know, but it just works and it's catchy. The crazy good dialogue, I thought, works really well still.
Yeah.
These people would probably be geniuses if they actually were capable of talking the way that they do because their vocabulary is extreme, you know? Like,
yeah.
We'll show more examples of that a little later, but I love the Arizona vibe.
Yeah, and the same thing, like Breaking Bad's New Mexico, but like just like the skyline like deserves its own billing for like best supporting actor.
Yes, definitely. Because I mean, if it was called Raising Children or something, and you didn't know the location, you would know it was Arizona.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. We just did this, but the acting. Like, pretty much everybody is great in this. I don't know of anybody that actually bothered me.
I didn't notice this. Is this a Coen Brothers film?
It is.
I always thought like Lebowski was like their debut. I didn't realize they went back into like the freaking late 80s.
Yeah, I think it's very, very early for them. But
okay.
But yeah, it's them. But yeah, just the acting. And then I got a couple more that I want to just open up. The chase scenes I thought were great.
Oh, shit, yeah.
They still work because it's like, it's chaos, but it's really well planned out, like perfect chaos.
Yeah.
And then the last one I've got is the, so they don't force it down your throat, but the baby and the Leonard Small's character, the biker, both seem to have a magical quality, but they don't ever define, you know, they don't ever like tell you for sure that the biker is a magician, like he's a wizard, you know?
Yeah. Same with the baby. Cause like, I mean, even if the baby's only power is being sat down middle of the fucking highway and not getting hit.
Yeah.
Like by chance, like that's a superpower right there.
Yeah, for sure. But like even Leonard Smalls, the biker guy, seems to really like the baby as soon as he picks him up because he like straps him to the front of the motorcycle, like, and kind of tenderly takes care of him. And he's got those like little booties on the side.
And you also know how car seats work. Like he had clips. He had to have clips on his handlebars to actually. Right. So he was waiting for him to scoop up.
Yeah, exactly. So everybody just falls in love with the baby immediately. And then, you know, that Leonard like catches the fly.
Yeah.
You know, he like lights a match like seemingly out of nowhere. He disappears. He reappears in a puff of smoke. You know, yep. Like he seems, but they don't actually, that could all plausibly be explained. You know what I mean? So, you have anything you want to mention for things that worked for you really well? And that was your first viewing.
Yeah, last time we talked about a Coen Brothers film, it was Big Lebowski. And this predates The Simpsons, but I could see, like, I was thinking, like, The Simpsons kind of inspired Big Lebowski as far as like, surrealism goes. But now yeah. I realize this inspired The Simpsons quite a bit, which then is, like, yeah. it's The Simpsons started out as a cartoon that was meant to be a sitcom. So the whole idea was, like, we're not doing anything out of the ordinary, but if we want something, like, somewhat weird to happen, we don't have to pay for a set or go on location or hire actors. We could just draw it. And that's why the show got so weird in the early seasons. And yeah. I just got the whole vibe with, like, there's, like, leaving the bank and then, like, the money bag explodes and, like, the car just goes, It's so overdone. When they climb out, when John Goodman and the other guy escape from prison and they climb out of the hole and they're screaming for, like, 10 minutes. Like, It's to the point of being obnoxious, but it's not obnoxious.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. They are pushing it as far as they can without it being like, well, that wouldn't happen.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Rob, I have written down here that you wanted to give us a quick report on a claim that you filed.
Oh, yeah. So last week's sponsor is Bomb Filter Building Insurance. So what happened last week during our tournament, the Pick Dan Cleet and the You're a Mean One, Mr. Grinch song destroyed our destroyed the Ashik Arena. Now, when filing an insurance claim, there's lots of things that you need to consider. For once, we had to prove damages. So, like, we had different vendors for the concessions. We had Admiral, General, Sergeant, Colonels. We had Santa Blob, Sparkling Nog. We had Nay-Nays and Scabs. Mm-hmm. I turned receipts and invoices to prove how much sales we make per event to prove damages, because now we're not making that money anymore. On top of the infrastructure, which is like as flesh regenerate, you could prolapse and heal. So there's a lot of red tape I got to jump through with the insurance company to get the Ass Cheek Arena rebuilt. I'm not sure if they're on my shit list yet or not. I feel like they're doing their due diligence, but once again, like, it is, who's at fault here? Was it our fault for having money invested in the arena that hosts events of this nature? Is it the European one wrong for not being a visible entity, which is why Pitt Van Cleef, who also could be blamed, leveled the entire arena? So, like,
well, yeah, he killed the whole production crew who weren't there to put out the Mario flames.
Yeah. Oh, so yeah.
But you're right. I mean, if he killed half the staff.
Oh, fuck, it was Mario. Yeah, that's right. He went into the ass tunnels in the previous episode, and then Mario brought up the fireballs. Yeah, I'm mixed up right now because they were just shouting shit back and forth to me,
it's a lot to deal with.
Yeah.
It was a mistake. It was a mistake to fill the arena with hot gases. But that insurance company that you're talking about is also, like every insurance company, full of hot air as well. So, I don't know exactly who's to blame. But yeah, I guess we'll just have to keep getting updates on this situation as we go.
I'm up to my back in receipts, man. So, well,
yeah, like Luther Crank, Christmas time.
Oh, okay, movie.
God. All right, let's move on to test number six. And thank you for the update. Everyone's wondering what's going on with the arena, I'm sure. So,
yeah.
Test number six is the new to meter, which is basically the anti-trope. So we're just going to talk about everything that's like an original concept in this movie, which, you know, we're going to stretch it a bit here and there. But things that that we thought were innovative, maybe.
Yeah.
Test number six, the new to meter.
You can't go wrong when your story is strong. So don't be a dope. Knock off them tropes. Yeah.
They're sleeping, so I stopped driving.
Yeah, nice. All right, the cop and con true love thing. It's usually two cons, or it's usually two cops. It's not usually a cop and a con. And even when it is, they're not really in love. It's just happenstance.
Yeah.
But this is like Princess Bride level true love. And it's between two people of very different life paths, which is cool.
Yeah.
Number two, I thought it was really funny that Nathan Arizona's place is called Unpainted Arizona. Like the fact that he's highlighting that all his furniture and everything is unpainted. Like he could just be a furniture store owner and it would work, but it's even funnier the fact that they went with the unpainted concept.
Not to make another Breaking Bad comparison, but remember when Parker was going off about how they saved like $3 on the pizza because no one cut it?
Yeah.
He's like, they passed the savings on to you.
Yeah, just that extra level is appreciated. Yeah. You know? I'm going to mention it again, but I wrote that I would usually probably hate the music, but in this, for some reason, I really love it. So to me, it's like opens up a whole, not that I've ever like gone searching for like Whistling Banjo Arizona theme music, but
yeah,
it was new to me that I even was willing to listen. And I just find myself every once in a while going,
yeah, it's way better than Wild Hogs where they changed like the soundtrack music every 3 seconds. It was like Highway to Hell, then Back in Black. And then it was like Out of Mind. And it was like announced the song. And then
it's pretty much like, look at how much money we were able to spend on music.
Yeah.
The family awkward picture transition tool that they used was still kind of funny, you know, that he's like, we're about to pop money, you know? But it was also like that black and white transitions, which was what I thought was pretty cool. Good.
And it also looked kind of like almost like a family mugshot, which is like,
yeah.
It was what may become. So,
yeah, that's cool. That's a good point. I loved the, and I'm going to mention this again in our next test, but it deserves to be mentioned twice. The tracking like shot through the house, like when they're following Nick Cage as he's running through the house. I thought that was really cool.
They have
some more stuff I'm going to talk about next test, but I just wanted to say that like watching Nick Cage, and it kind of had like a Cloverfield or like Blair Witch feel to it where the camera's totally unsteady, but it made it feel more real.
It's almost like that MTV Fear Show when they went into like haunted mansions and the camera was strapped to them. So like he probably had like a mount on his back or something and he was running down the stairs.
But it looked like you were the cop in that case. Like,
yeah,
right on his tail, you know? For me, I thought that High was one of my first anti-heroes because I will mention this again, but it's one of my early favorites as a kid. I probably watched this a little early. Probably earlier than I should have, but he being the anti-hero, he's like a total jerk who's like robbing people at gunpoint. Although it's not loaded, he's still representing that he's going to kill you and like give me the money from a small business, you know.
Yeah, but you love it. You know what, too, though, in his defense, like when you work at a convenience store, your job is not loss prevention. You just hand the shit over and go home.
That's what most people I think would tell you is like, just give the money away because it's not worth, you know, like obviously even the store owner would tell you to just hand the money over because any one night isn't going to like totally ruin, you know, the store or anything. But the parallel of High and the Baby is what I wrote, which by that, I mean, you remember the scene where Nathan Jr. is like climbing under the crib? And High like, pulls, you know, they shoot it from like under the crib and then High like, pulls him out from under. And then when High is running away from the biker, he crawls under the car and they take the same shot from under the car as they did for the under the crib with Nathan Jr. And the biker pulls him out and they don't. Yeah. Another example of where they like let you get it if you get it and they don't force it down your throat. Like nowadays, they would find a way to show you for sure. Like they would flash back to the baby under the crib or something. Yeah. They would do the work for you, which is annoying. So I really like when they, you know, give you subtle hints.
Yeah. Or like earlier in the film, like another example of it being done poorly is when they'll like zoom in on like the rose on the nightstand and hold it for like 10 seconds.
Yeah.
Going like a rose later.
Right. Exactly. The grenade pin surprise is the last one I have.
Okay.
That was another one that was like pretty new to me, is that like they didn't show it as it happened. Like Hyde just gets uppercutted into like heaven and lands back down. And you're just feeling like he's totally defeated, you know, like the biker's about to shoot him with both barrels of like both shotguns. And High is totally screwed, but then he like lifts his hand up and he's got the little pin on his finger. And then he apologizes to the biker, you know. Yeah. and then the biker blows up. And I thought that was really cool, you know, really well executed.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I've got. Anything you want to mention? Should we just keep trucking away?
Yeah, I like the everything going back to its rightful place after like it should not. That doesn't happen a lot of the time. Where it's like, yeah, all right, I should have gone to fucking jail.
Yeah.
You think the robbers, like John Goodman, would have gotten like away scot-free with the baby. Nathan Arizona, he's like, I get it. So, I mean, I'm not gonna call the cops, just get out of here. Like you don't see that happen, and like on top of that, when you do see it happen occasionally, you're pissed off. But in this one, it was like everything kind of went back to its rightful place. It's all good people that got mixed up with some bad shit, and then they all kind of meet an understanding, and then they just kind of go their separate ways.
Yeah, that's fair. And the one like really truly evil guy like explodes into a million pieces.
Yeah.
Test number 7 is our good CGI test. So it's the exact opposite of our other. We're not going to do a sliding scale for this one. We're just going to mention the times that we thought that the CGI practical effects, that kind of special effects stuff, was really good. So let's do test number 7, good CGI.
Good CGI. Test data.
That was beautiful. number one, Leonard.
That was our last segment, and the hot dog fell off the drill.
Oh, okay, gotcha. No more swiping. Leonard Smalls attacking innocent creatures was really cool. So yeah, it's horrible, but I wrote bunny bomb, gecko gunfire, and flower fire. Because he blows up a bunny with a grenade, he shoots like a lizard off a rock, and then the flower just catches fire as he drives by. All cool effects. I don't know how they lit the flower like that, you know?
I'm guessing they got like a rotisserie chicken and a piece of string.
Just pop the leg off. Number two, the Steadicam shot over the bike, over the fountain, and then up the ladder and into Mrs. Arizona's mouth.
Yeah.
With the horrible, like, shrieking music behind it. Like, really, like, ups your heart rate, you know?
Yeah.
So I wanted to mention that shot. I thought it was really cool the way that I think it was a Steadicam. I don't really know. I don't exactly know how they executed it, but every time that I don't exactly know, I always have to mention it. Right.
Yeah.
The exploding like grocery store aisles.
Yeah.
Was cool. Like the way that they, went through, you know, you see Cage like running, and they're following from the other side of the aisle. So you see him go from aisle to aisle, and then he takes a turn down. And you don't know that clerk has a big shotgun, but the sodas just explode, and then the papers explode.
I think they had a roll of paper, like a pack of paper towels too. And the way, like you could tell it was a shotgun because the thing is spread everywhere.
Yeah, right.
It just like blew out like a cloud.
And the guy's just kind of guessing, you know?
Yeah.
The following camera work for the chase, which I already mentioned, but that goes for like in the backyard with a dog shot and, you know, the gunfire, like on the road looked really cool, you know, just really well done. Number 5, Randall Tex Cobb. That is Leonard Smalls, the biker guy, his makeup. I thought he just looked like I wouldn't even talk to that guy.
There's one scene that really bothered me. And I've thought about like a dozen times since I watched this couple. You could tell like he's got unwashed skin under all that leather. Yes. First of all, when I show the close up of his mouth and the smoke was swirling around in it.
Yes,
but like, dude, his breath like cabbage and fucking like old coleslaw. Like it's just like disgusting.
Some kind of hickory
tobacco. Yeah.
Gail throwing H, that's Gail is John Goodman throwing HI through the wall.
It's always funny when John Goodman throws somebody.
Yeah. And I thought that the wall, like separating the way that it did, looked really good. Like it looked like a believable wall, but they were able to make it look light, but it is, it's like in a trailer too. So I don't know if that would be, if there would be like heavy, I don't think there'd be like cement or metal support beams in there, I guess is what I'm saying. Yeah, it'd be like a light wood.
They're typically just drywall and like a gap between the inside and outside wall.
Yeah, exactly. So I think it would be totally plausible, you know?
Yeah.
The ink bomb was cool. Cool effects. There's a couple car explosions that look really good. The biker, you know, explosions are cool. And I wrote that all the HI shots from the ground, I kind of mentioned the crib one already, but they have ones where he's being dragged behind the bike. You know, and they shoot it from like when he's laying on the ground that looking up at the biker. So he looks even more intimidating. And then they had a shot where they must've strapped the camera to the side of the bike and he's coming out of the bank and then high hits him with the plank, but it like you're going by all the like wood panels on the fence and making the
good.
Yeah, it was really cool. Agreed. So I guess in closing, they did it. My point was that they did a great job of stretching the budget for the special effects in the film because there was no like computer graphics, you know, at all.
Yeah, it was like expertly disorienting, like the bike scene when he's going down like the dock, and it follows it so quickly. It's like that could be a complete soundstage and you wouldn't know. It could be
or it could be.
There's no way to tell. Done.
Yeah, really cool. They just did some really interesting things with the camera that made it seem like a higher budget film than I think it was.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to do my additional musings. And then do you want to throw out, like, I'm going to ask you basically for your, you know, general thoughts.
Okay.
Your closing review.
Yeah.
So let's hop into our additional musing section. This is basically illogical inconsistencies. This time I'm going to blast it a little bit because it had some poor taste stuff in there, but we'll get to that. Okay. I just want to mention, finally, last time I say it, crazy fun dialogue. It just makes the movie more watchable because you don't remember everything that's said, you know, or anywhere close. I wanted to mention the Crank's neighbor in the metal shop. I know I actually threw out Raising Arizona when I was talking about him in Christmas with the Cranks, but there he was, his like coworker.
You know what's funny about that too, though? It was, this was 1987 or 89, right?
87.
87. And Cranks was 2004 and he only looks 5 years older.
Yeah. Right. Prove it.
He must've hit 30 years old and then like turned 50 and stayed 50.
Yeah.
For like 30 years.
Some people do that.
Yeah.
It's kind of a weird thing. The entire opening monologue at first glance is too long, right? But if you're listening to it, it's super solid and it's totally necessary.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to shout out to most Nicolas Cage movies where he narrates are his films. You have The Weatherman. You have Bringing Out Your Dead. Have you seen that? Where he's like the tired he's like a tired paramedic on the verge of a mental breakdown, picking up like bodies and stuff. And like he's in the voiceovers throughout the whole film. And it's like,
oh, cool.
That's like he nails it.
Yeah. Never seen it. But yeah, he does a great job in this one for sure. I wanted to ask you how you would feel about having 5 children at once.
No, I wouldn't. I would somehow lie to my wife and say there were only 2 and give 3 away and say, you must be delusional with pregnancy and the labor. You must have been seeing double. And I would have just like slid the baby down the hall in a bedpan and hope someone rushed.
On the subject of 5 babies, Harry, Barry, Larry, Gary, and Nathan Jr. I think that's kind of mean.
Yeah.
Dr. Spock's baby and child care book. That's a real thing.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I wanted to know because I was like, really? Is there a Dr. Spock out there? Like, he's probably gone now, but I looked it up. It's a real book.
All right.
The Arizona's Arizona-style wallpaper I thought was perfect for Nathan Arizona. Stealing a baby, not so good. We're going to get into the poor taste kind of stuff right now. Not good. Don't steal babies.
No, they have a sick, there's a Louis C.K. joke where he's like talking about like how his kid won't eat breakfast or whatever.
Yeah.
And he's like, you need to eat. You have a social security number. You're on the fucking grid. They know I have you. don't steal a kid for the same reason. Like that kid is like, I'm not saying they have like ear tags, like a fucking like rescue dog, but like kid goes missing, they're going to find it in most cases.
Definitely. Don't take it unless it slid to you on a hospital pan.
Yeah. That's fair game.
menstrual cramps joke. The guy who was like totally trans. So that was definitely a transphobic joke in the beginning when they're in jail together. The breastfeeding commentary was not the best. It's like these two guys want to see your boobs. That's basically the whole joke.
Yeah.
And then I got a couple more, but my wife has more sense than that thing that Nathan Arizona says to that same employee that I was talking about before.
Yeah.
Just seemed to be like a thing that she was used to hearing, which is not so cool.
Yeah.
Ed says about Nathan Jr. when handing him off to High, she says, "Mind his little fontanelle." And I had no idea what that was. I looked that up. It is the soft spot of the skull. And if you don't know, the soft spot actually helps with the skull growth because it's kind of like the place where the two plates of plate tectonics don't meet yet. So there's room for the skull to increase, which I just...
I'll get out too, because like the head's got to compress to make its way out when it's born.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So it's a flex point. Yeah, but I didn't know it was called a fontanelle. So when she said, but that's an example of the kind of dialogue. Like they definitely looked that up.
Yeah.
You know, maybe don't scream so loud when you break out of prison.
they did swim through shit though.
Yeah, they did. It was definitely very Shawshank.
Yeah.
The strength of Goodman to lift Forsythe out of the mud upside down would be incredible. Just saying.
When like he just grabs the toad and fucking whips it into the tree as hard as he can.
I have not seen that movie.
It's Homer's The Odyssey, but with like with the that cast,
right? Clooney and Tim Blake Nelson and John Turturro, right? Yeah, we were saying before. Hey, little father's lounge for you.
Okay.
Did you see the size of the baby bottle at the table? Dude, that was like a pint of milk. The baby is like 2 weeks old.
Hey, that's the thing. That's one of the suspending disbelief things I let slide. Like you see it, and like there's like a Frasier and a Seinfeld episode where like there's a baby born in a taxi cab and then they pick it up 6 months old.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah, it's a union thing. Like babies don't crawl to like 6 or 8 months. Like I have a 7-month-old and he's like on the verge of crawling, you know? Yeah. And these kids were scooting across the fucking bedroom like little like rats.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right. No, the baby logic doesn't make much sense. I just wanted to throw that out there. Another piece of like poor taste though is the adoption monologue by Glenn. I know it's supposed to be funny, but the part where he's like they have a Negro whose heart was born with his heart on the outside and stuff. I was like, oh, this is like tough to listen to, you know?
Yeah,
like I didn't want to. What's that?
My semen doesn't work.
Yeah, kind of my semen doesn't work. I thought about including that in the clip because he does a great job acting that out, but it's a little tough. The cop shot into the house in that scene.
Yeah.
The baby lifts the hoodie up, right? And then he sees that they're about to crash into the fence and then he like pulls it back down. I'm just wondering how many takes that took.
Yeah. I don't know. A lot.
A ton, yeah. Ty's letter to Ed and Nathan Jr. is genuinely touching.
Yeah.
Ed is like a real badass because she tells off like the Snoke brothers, Gail and Evel. And, just wanted to mention, she is a cool, like strong female character.
Yeah.
Very like Sarah Connor, you know?
Yeah.
If Gail and Evel plan to claim the money with Nathan Jr., aren't they risking turning themselves in?
Yeah, but they're idiots. So,
right. So I guess it works. Yeah. John Goodman was physically intimidating in this movie.
Yeah.
Like, he hadn't hit that point where he was, like, super, super heavy. So, like, he was just, like, a big dude who, like, was plausibly able to throw Nick Cage through a wall. So
he always had the build of, even in, like, Roseanne, it's like, you could tell he was probably, like, a linebacker. And yeah. then, like, he injury where he couldn't, like, hit the gym as hard as he used to, and it turned to fat.
Yeah. Yeah. It happens, right? I mean.
Yeah.
I can't go without mentioning the balloon scene.
Okay.
I thought about throwing it in the dialogue, but I just wanted to mention the old timer at the gas station when what's his faith? Forsythe, Evel Snote is like asking about whether he needs fasteners or like pins or whatever. And the guy is like, they're self-contained, fairly explanatory. He's like, he grabs the balloons and he puts them on the counter and he's like, oh, do these blow up in funny shapes? And the old guy's like, not unless round is funny. And then, Evel has him count to like 1,000 or something, right? And the old timer's at, he's like 791 Mississippi, 790. Nah, bullshit. And then he stands up and he looks out and they're coming back and screaming at the top of their lungs. That scene was just really good.
Yeah.
Really funny. Had to mention it. the baby had been, and this is part of the magical quality, but the baby had been Nathan, Ed, Glenn, and Gale Jr. during this movie.
Yeah.
The biker goes into the trailer, rustles some papers, looks up the wall, and it just says in capital letters, fart. that part got me.
Yeah.
I thought almost the CGI moment, but it's too quick, too stupid. The knife in the board trick, like when I like brings the board up and doesn't even realize he's having a knife thrown in them.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool. Why was High nauseous?
I don't know.
It was weird to me. I just thought maybe like it was like an anxiety thing or something. I have no idea. The guy just has that effect on you. Maybe he smells. Maybe it was his breath.
Yeah, could be.
All right, a couple more, and then we'll go to you for your thoughts and close this thing out. Right. As a kid, I know I got a couple listeners who know this already, but as a kid, I called Leonard Smalls the man from hell, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that became the name of the movie for us. So, like, I would tell my grandma that I wanted to watch The Man from Hell. Not Raising Arizona, because I didn't know the name of the movie, but I would say I want to watch The Man from Hell. And I think maybe that's the implication. I don't know. Maybe it's one of those like kids say truthful things sometimes, you know, but like he kind of comes in like on the highway in a puff of smoke.
Yeah.
Nathan Arizona with one last, unless you want a line of credit. In fact, I'd rather handle it that way. Just to be a, you know, a cheapskate again. And two more. The dream makes me cry every time.
That's a good dream sequence.
Dude, it's like, I have some extra sentimental reasons that I don't want to get into because it's personal, but not super interesting. I watched it and like started breaking up. So I wrote down that the food in the dream was ridiculous because I had to mention that just to bring myself back. Yeah. There's like 80 breadsticks on that table in the dream.
What you're talking about when they're old men and women, right?
Yeah, yeah. Dude, there's like 3 baskets of breadsticks and there's like 30 in each. It's insane.
It's like you robbed an Olive Garden on the way back.
Yeah, right. All right, man. Hey, you want to give us your thoughts on the movie?
Real quickly, there's one thing that wasn't mentioned. I'm surprised.
Oh, yeah, sure.
When they return Nathan Jr. and they put him in the crib, Nathan Arizona places down his loaded revolver in the crib.
Oh, does he? Oh, shit. Anyway,
he just puts it down gently in there, like, oh, whatever. It's not an intruder.
Oh, my God.
Like a 45 caliber six shooter.
That's a heavy weapon for sure.
Yeah. My overall thoughts on the movie is like, I'm a big Nicolas Cage fan. I even like the flops. I think he's a genuine, sincere actor. I think a lot of Hollywood shit goes on. I don't think he was in that much trouble financially as people say he was, and just taking pay off the IRS because you just file for bankruptcy. Why would you do that?
Right.
But I think like the Funny or Die videos. I just like being in movies, Gary.
I think for sure. He does.
I think this is one of the earlier ones. I went through a Nicolas Cage ranked list. I sent it to you, and it, like 90 some odd movies, 96 movies, and I've seen 72 of them. When we were trying to decide what good Nicolas Cage movie to watch, and I don't know, it's got like it's Coen Brothers. It has that like Lebowski Simpsons-esque humor.
It does.
It's fast paced. It's unbelievable if you're watching it from the outside, but if you're fully submerged, it's like, oh, that could happen. It's just like hyper surrealism, I guess I'd call it. It's where it's like not fantastical and whimsical. It's just like it's rooted in the real world, but it's extraordinary shit happening to regular people. And I think they knocked it out of the park with this. I'm surprised it's taken me this long in life to see it. It's just one of those things where people kept saying it and I thought it was something else, I think, and I just kind of broke off and didn't watch it. But it's definitely replay value. So I'll watch the shit out of it. Except not on Amazon Prime though, because we were watching Prime for this pod. Luckily, I had the DVD. It was New Year's Eve. I put it on at like 10 p.m. I was like, this is going to come off of Prime at midnight. So I'm like, oh, shit. I can't even pause. So I just,
It's crazy. Yeah. Man. It's constantly rotating.
Yeah.
Drives me crazy. All right. So I'll read off the bad credit names, and then we'll talk about a little bit about what we're doing for next week and season four. Which I'm excited about. So here are the back credit names for you from worst to first. Richard Hornong.
Okay.
Brad S. Mudgett. Star Fields.
Okay.
Randall Tex Cobb. That sounds like a famous baseball player or something to me, but that's the biker.
It sounds like a salad.
Yeah, it does. Jane Muskie.
Ew.
Henry Tank, which is only funny if you take the common nickname for Henry.
Yeah.
Hank Tank. Ben Freed on banjo, who must be very good at banjo.
Yeah.
Two more. Spanky Spangler. And then my personal favorite, Roger Pancake.
That's a good name.
All right, so next week, over all social media platforms that we reviewed or asked rather for a poll, we put up Next and Sorcerer's Apprentice, and Sorcerer's Apprentice seems to have won that one outright. So
have you seen that?
No.
It's enjoyable. It's not good.
Okay.
I liked it. It's long. Right, it's long hair, Nicolas Cage. So it's a, sweet. It's a weird hairline.
Yeah. Can't wait to make fun of that then. All right, cool. So next week is going to be the first of season four, and we are reformatting. We're bringing you the same kind of content. We're just going to bundle it up a little different, and I think much for the better, more entertaining. And I'm very excited for the next, the worst movie ever made. Do you want to plug our audio?
Yes. So like I always say, we're native to Anchor FM, which is a Spotify property. It gets us on Google Play. It gets us on Pocket Cast. It gets us on Apple and iTunes. If you have the RSS feed from Anchor, you can put it into any podcast app, such as Overcast or Podcast Addict. I also want to say that I've been working behind the scenes a little bit. We will be announcing a Patreon soon with some cool incentives and like bonus content things. We're growing organically, but organic growth is kind of slow. So it's just the nature of building up a property or a show from the beginning. We do have climbing listening numbers, and we want to, we want to give our listeners a chance to get some behind the scenes stuff, get some maybe extra commentaries down the line.
Bonus material. Merch. Even
movies for us to review, stuff like that. And then Chris, talk about the socials and stuff.
Yeah, we have a Reddit community. We have a Twitter. We have a TikTok. Instagram, which is where I would suggest you go. As per usual, that's where we're most active. We post there all the time. Yeah, and we got a stupid little TikTok. So hit us up there if you want our content there. We don't do a whole lot of posting on TikTok, but if you demand it, we will give it to you. So yeah, check us out on Instagram, The Worst Movie Ever Made. And you could always email us at worstmovieevermade@gmail.com. And we will be happy to shout you out on the show for that Gmail. But that's a limited time offer now. So
yeah.
So do that soon if you so desire. Thank you very much for listening.
All right. Thanks, guys. We'll see you next week.